And so forth and so on, there begins to be, people who don't agree on certain things, or people who think certain things passed away, this, that, and the other, and all that. So we, for us to try as the corporate church in the earth to build unity based on what we all know, it's not going to work.
Right.
Matter of fact, we've tried to do that since about 1500 or 500 years ago, since the Reformation. We've tried in the Protestant church to do that, and all it's done is caused us to split off into different groups. A lot of denominations were formed because they got mad at the guy that believed what they didn't believe, so they went and started their own. Some were started because God moved and revealed something. You know, with Martin Luther, the thing had become, in his day, you earned your way to heaven. And he found the scripture that said the just shall live by faith. It wasn't what I do to earn my way in. It was what Jesus did for me, so I can put my trust in what he's done and let his blood cleanse me and be in him, in Christ. And I get in through him. He's the door,
Amen.
Not my works.
Yes.
So that's something that needed to be rebelled against, that kind of thinking.
Right.
That earning your way to heaven, that works thinking.
Right.
Amen. But then there are other things that weren't really, and then there's some denominations that believe things that aren't even scriptural. So, but well, the point I'm wanting here to make here, and I've maybe taken a little too long to make it, is that unity is not going to be built that way. You're always going to see something a little different than somebody else in the body of Christ.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's not going to work on a local level either. If your pastor doesn't upset you a little bit now and then, you're probably in the wrong church. Amen? Because a pastor, if he's preaching truth and the Holy Spirit is working through him, the Spirit of God's going to show us not only good things and comforting things and encouraging things, and he's going to help us, and there's always a hope, but he's also going to show us where we're wrong.
Yeah.
Amen.
That's good.
Because he knows that if we keep living that way, we're going to end up in trouble. The enemy's going to make merchandise of us somehow.
Yeah.
Right.
And, you know, the way I pastor this church is not the way somebody else is going to pastor the church.
That's true.
Amen?
Yeah.
Peter and John hung out together after Jesus went back to heaven, didn't he?
Yes.
We see them at the gate, beautiful. But you talk about opposite personalities. You got it right there in Peter and John.
Yeah.
Peter was the let's go for it. You know, he was part of the ready fire aim crew.
Right.
Amen.
Wasn't he?
Amen.
You got his face. You pulled out the swords and sorted it out later.
Amen.
I mean, that was kind of his. He's that type A aggressive personality, right? Obvious, right? But John, he's totally different. You know, they're at the Last Supper, and Jesus reveals that somebody there is possessed of the enemy and going to betray him. Peter goes, he looks at John, because John's sitting right next to Jesus, but leaning over on Jesus' breast. He just loves sitting there giving Jesus a hug all the time. And Peter goes, ask him who it is. Right? Because he was probably going to say, we'll take him outside, we'll deal with this situation.
Amen.
But after they got saved and sanctified, they were working together.
Yeah.
At the gate, beautiful. They come to the man at the gate, beautiful. And the man, you know the story, how he was healed. Peter looks at the guy, and he did a total Simon Peter anointing thing. He reached down and he said, I don't have my wallet, but such as I have, give I unto you. Get up!
Amen.
Now, if John would have ministered to him, he probably would have looked at him and said, oh, wait a minute, let me get down and give you a hug.
Amen.
When I hug people, the anointing flows. And he's probably right. You know, if you study John's writings, he's always talking about the love of God. He had the revelation of love. He referred to himself as that disciple which Jesus loved. You know what Sabrina said about this lesson they're getting ready to do? I suggest, ladies, if at all possible, you connect with that. Because as a pastor, what I've seen, I had to come through this myself and sort this all out for my own life. But what I see is a lot of people know they're supposed to love God, but a lot of Christians won't let God love them.
Amen.
Because they've got some kind of criteria or some kind of standard that they think he loves within that box they have, and outside of that, it doesn't happen.
Right.
That's not true.
Right.
Amen.
if you read the history of John, he was the last disciple that died. He was the only one that wasn't martyred. They tried to kill him in Rome in boiling oil, but he came out. He was uncooked, so they pulled him out. Freaked him totally out, so they put him on the Isle of Patmos, where he got the revelation of the revelation. And but they said that as he was a very, very old man, they would carry him to their meetings. And they would let him, because he was the elder and the last living apostle of the Lamb, they would let him speak first. And they said that he would always say this, love one another, love one another, love one another, love one another. His whole revelation was about love. Amen? And so we're all different personalities. We need the Simon Peters. We need the rock. We need that one that, you know, I mean, you read Peter's history after he got in that place of yielding himself to God. He was powerful. The Bible says that the glory cloud would come on him, the hand of the Lord. It uses the word shadow, but it actually means to overshadow. Just like when Mary, the angel told her that the Lord's going to overshadow you, the Holy Spirit's going to overshadow you. The Holy Ghost would overshadow him. And then the next word actually means a luminous cloud. He would walk in a glory cloud at times. To where if you got within that overshadowing and that luminous cloud that was coming out from him, whatever wasn't of God left you.
Yes.
And whatever was of God went into you.
Amen.
So he walked in a powerful place. Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
And all the type A's said, amen.
Amen.
But the point I'm making is that we can't try to be in unity, true spiritual unity, based on some kind of soulish understanding. It's got to be a heart thing. Amen. Now here in Genesis 11, I'm just going to be able to probably introduce this today. I'm not going to be able to go very far with it. We see something that's just amazing. I know you've heard it before. Let's read it real quick. Verse 1. The whole earth. Now, this is after the Noahic flood, and Noah's sons went out, and they began to reproduce. And there was a man by the name of Nimrod who rebelled against God. He really was the start of the Antichrist spirit on the earth after the earth was cleansed with water and Noah's sons and all of that were left. This was the beginning of the Antichrist spirit. So, we don't have time to go into all that, but it says, the whole earth was of one language and one speech. And it came to pass, as they journeyed from the east, that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there. Now God had told them, he told Noah, the same thing he told Adam, fill the earth. But these guys say, no, we're not going with God's plan. We're going to do our thing. We're going to go to this one place, and we're going to rebel against God. And if you go into it and study it and so forth, they basically were saying, we're going to rebel against God. We're going to do our own thing. We're going to build this tower so that we can't be drowned by a flood. And not only that, if you get into it and you study it, they were basically building a tower to reach to heaven so they could displace God. Because that's Antichrist spirit. See, the devil still thinks he's going to be God.
Yeah.
He is that blind. He is that ignorant. Now, he's just, that's where he's at. He dwells in darkness. And so he began to work through this group of people to try to use them to set up his fortress here on the earth and eventually take over the throne of God. He's still trying to do the same thing today. There's a lot of things, little rabbit trails I can get off on this, but I'm trying to stay with making the main thing here. Amen? They said one to another, go to, let us make brick, burn them thoroughly. They had brick for stone, slime had they for mortar. And they said, go to, let us, notice the words us here. Go to, let us build us a city and a tower whose top may reach unto heaven, and let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of men builded. And the Lord said, now look at this. This is amazing. These people weren't anointed of God. They didn't have the Holy Spirit working with them. Just the opposite was true. The Lord says, behold, the people is one. Now, how were they one? Well, it says they had one language and one speech. It wasn't just that they all spoke the same dialect. It was that they all had a purpose, a goal, a focus, and they lived their lives based on that.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
They lived, their focus, their vision was, here's what we want to do, and everything else has to play into that. everything, we're gonna, whatever we have to push aside, forget about, or whatever, in order for this thing that we're to do here, we're going to serve that purpose, we're going to focus on that, and that's what we're going to be about.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen?
It says, the people is one, and they have all one language, and this they begin to do, and now nothing will be restrained from them, which they have imagined to do. Now notice what this says here. They imagine, they had an image in their mind. I'm sure, you know, their leader, he, you know, once he got this download from the devil, amen, and he preached, proclaimed it to them, taught it to them, gave them the plan. Here's the vision. See, the devil's a counterfeiter. He counterfeits every kind of gift of the Spirit or every kind of thing God does. And so there was this demonic vision that was imparted to these people. It was a corporate vision. Over in the book of 1 Samuel, the Bible talks about, because of the bad spiritual condition in the land and the perversion of the priesthood ministry, it says one of the big problems in Israel at that time, when Samuel was a little boy and brought into the temple where Eli was the priest, it says that part of the problem was there was no open vision. And when you study that out, what it means is they were in a position where God had to back away from them, and they didn't know what God was saying to them for their day. So there was a disunity. There was people doing all these different things. Whatever feels good, do it. Do it your own way. And God wasn't in any of it.
Right.
And problems were happening, and the blessing of God wasn't on the land.
Right.
Hallelujah. Nothing will be restrained from them which they have imagined to do. And then God says, go to, let us go down there, confound their language that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord scattered them abroad from thence upon the face of all the earth, and they left off to build the city. Therefore is the name of it called Babel, because the Lord did theirs confound the language of all the earth, and from thence did the Lord scatter them abroad upon the face of all the earth. Babylon, Babel. Read the book of Revelation where that spirit of Babylon is still operating in the earth, and it's still trying to do the same things that were accomplished here, if you study it out. Matter of fact, there's a really good book, I read it recently, called The Babylon Code. The Babylon Code. If you get a chance to get a copy of that, it's really interesting. They did a lot of research, and you can see how that spirit has operated down through the generations and even into our day. And operates through people. But the point I wanted you to see here is that even people who didn't have the Spirit of God, and even people who had an evil purpose, God said they're one. They're together. They're unified. And now nothing is going to stop them. So he had to divinely intervene, and he had the right to, because they were fighting against his will. They were, you know, breaking his plan and his will for mankind. To confuse them and scatter them. Amen? And that's what he did. Now turn with me over to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Let's take this into our day. I know you've heard a lot about unity over the years. I have too, and all that kind of thing. But there again, our unity has to be based on something that we can have unity over. What can we unify around? Let's just look for a minute here what Paul says here in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10. Now he's writing to this church. He's writing to a group of people, a corporate group of people like in this room right now. Now I beg of you, that word beseech means I beg of you, I implore you. He wasn't just saying, hey, I got an idea. Here's a little suggestion. He said, I beg of you. This is what he was writing in strong terms here, because he wanted to understand, you've got to do this. If you're going to have what God wants for you, you've got to do this. I beseech you, brethren, by the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, even invoke Jesus' name in this, that you all speak the same thing,
yes,
and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. I remember when I first read that scripture years ago, I thought, oh my God, how in the world could you ever do that? See, I was raised in church.
Yeah.
I was raised in a day where if you want to get a fight, all you have to do is go to church. Anything from the color of the carpet to who's wearing what hairdo or whether we got makeup on or not or whatever. We all have an opinion.
Yeah.
I'll leave that right there. So this scripture, based on what I thought he was saying here, looked absolutely ridiculous to me. How in the world? But see, there again, I didn't understand that our victory, and you might want to write this down, our victory is always in the Spirit.
Yes.
We're one body in the Spirit. We're one Spirit with the Lord. Therefore, we're one with one another. Corporately, we are one together as the corporate body of Christ. So if we're going to unify, it's got to be spiritual unity.
Yes.
Not emotional unity, not intellectual unity, although those things are an important part, and so forth and so on. We need the mind of Christ and so forth. But the unity that he's talking about here is more of a unity in the Spirit. Yes. And what Spirit is it that lives in us now that we're born again? The Spirit of God or the Spirit of love.
Yes.
God has faith. God has hope. He is love.
Amen.
Amen. When Moses said, God, I want to see your glory. I want to know who you are. I want to know your substance. What are you made of? Where are you coming from? God said, I'm merciful. He started explaining love things to him.
Amen.
The love of God. Now, some people think that, you know, when you talk about love, you're talking about huggy, kissy, gooey, gooey. God is very tender. He's very kind. He's very loving. Very compassionate. But there's the other side of love is that he loves you enough to tell you the truth. I used to say this. People didn't understand what I was saying. And, you know, just kind of get people's attention, wake them up while they're sleeping while you're preaching or something, you know. I used to say this. God loves you so much, he's going to kill you. He loves you so much, he wants to kill you. Now, I don't mean he wants to, you know, kill you physically where you die physically, or for you to, you know, never be able to be in heaven with him, like, you know, second death, separated from it. What he wants to do is kill the things that are in you that are not gonna enable him to love you, and you let him love you, and him to do through you what he wants to do.
Yes. That's good.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. I'll take another. The Bible says open rebuke is better than secret love. That doesn't mean that you become, you know, one of these Christians that thinks they're Captain Correction in the body of Christ. How many of you have seen the commercials, Captain Obvious? Well, there are people in the body of Christ, you know, they get a few scriptures under their belt, get a few principles down, kind of see a little truth here. And all of a sudden, they're going around, and if they see somebody not walking in what they perceive as truth or hold, you know, that principle, then all of a sudden they're Captain Correction. Yep. They're going to straighten them out. Well, if we see our brother sinning,
yeah,
we're to warn him in love.
Yes.
If our brother offends us, we are to go to him with the attitude of making peace.
Yeah.
Not getting a apology. You know, Pastor, that's good preaching. There is no scripture that says for you to ever get anybody to apologize to you. If there was ever any person on the face of the earth that ever deserved an apology, it was Jesus, and he never asked for one.
That's right. That's right. Yeah.
We got to get over ourselves.
Yep.
Yep. Amen.
We got to get over ourselves. Amen. Now, if somebody offends you and it's upsetting you and you see that you're having trouble with it, and you know, it's okay to go to somebody and say, hey, you know, I felt what you said to me wasn't very kind, and I want to walk in love with you and all this, so let's, you know, did I misunderstand you or what's going on? Yeah. But you know what I see with most people? They come with their guns loaded already. They already know what you said, why you said it, and what's wrong with you because you said it. It's amazing. Only one out of the three do they understand. That may be what you said. What your heart is, they don't know. And that's the part the Lord was warning us about when he says, don't judge other people. See, we've a lot of people, Christians, have translated that scripture today in, "Don't tell me I'm wrong."
Yeah, that's true.
That is good.
If I see you about to swallow some poison, and I tell you, "Don't swallow that, I don't care if you do like it, it's going to kill you," would that be the right thing to do?
Yes.
So there's nothing wrong with, you know, if you see somebody sinning, or they're really getting off into something where the enemy is going to make merchandise of them. But what you know about the Bible is what you know. Walk in it, and if you think somebody else is not walking in it, pray for them, and then ask God to make sure that, you know, He shows you where you don't know what you're talking about, too.
Amen.
Right.
Yep.
Hallelujah. Yeah. So see, this is what Paul was talking to this church about. I won't read the rest of the scriptures right below it there, but they were already splitting off into these factions. Well, I'm of Paul. Well, I'm of Apollos. Well, I'm of Peter. And then we got the super spiritual one. Well, I'm of Jesus. Peter and Paul, I mean, he just flat out, he rebuked them. He said, "I'm glad I didn't baptize any of you. Make you my disciple." What was he doing? He understood that we have to stay in that place of unity, loving one another. That's the only place that God can fully move in.
Right.
Amen.
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 Thank you, Lord.
For sake of time today, turn with me back over to the book of Psalms. To the Psalms. Psalm 133. Psalm 133. Now there again, please don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying that you can't have a discussion with somebody about a doctrine you believe versus what they believe and express your opinion. Of course you can. But it's one thing to discuss things. It's another thing to start assassinating somebody's character or having a wrong heart. See, some people don't want to be right. They just want to win an argument.
Yeah.
Yeah. Amen.
You know, I find out as a pastor, I got to a place, I haven't had this happen to me too much, but sometimes, somebody will come in and I have to stop and say, "Wait a minute, are you here to prove a point or do you want to discuss something?" Because if they're just here to make me believe their point or take their side in an argument or something like that, we're wasting our time talking.
Yes.
I'm not going to do that. Now, if they want to have a discussion, "Well, Pastor, here's what I feel this scripture says," and so forth, "and I've heard you preach it different, so let's talk about this." Hey, that's great. I had a guy one time years ago. He came to me one day, and he was very humble about it. He says, "You know, I heard you preach on tithing." And he said, I don't really believe it the way you believe it, so I wanted to talk with you about it." I said, "Great, let's talk." So we talked for about an hour. I shared with him what I saw in the Word in that area. He shared with me what he saw. When we left, we still didn't agree. But he went back. You know, but there was no love lost between us.
There you go.
When he went back to the place where he'd come from before, and started a business he'd had before, and it was totally flopping. It wasn't working at all. And so he got in prayer and fasting. He said he had a little money left. He said, "God, I'll do whatever you tell me to do. This thing has got to go." And the Lord said, "Tithe." He called me and told me this.
That's good.
He said, "Tithe." And he said, "Well, God, I don't believe it the way Pastor Pursell preached it or the way, you know, but you said, I told you I'd do whatever, so I'm doing." And so he started tithing. And his business immediately took off. Things went the other direction, and he started prospering. And he called me. He was overseas. He called me from overseas. So I just wanted to tell you the story.
Amen.
Now, did I feel? "Yeah, I set that brother straight." God went, No! I didn't have to, you know, "Well, he doesn't believe in time." I didn't have to take that attitude. I just shared with him how I saw things.
Yeah.
Stayed in love with the brother, prayed for him, blessed him.
Right.
See, if you do know something that's right, and somebody is missing him there, you need to pray for them. Because
yeah.
The enemy is going to victimize them in that area.
Yes.
Amen. And always pray for yourself. Yes. On a real, regular basis, always ask the Lord, "Lord, where am I deceived?"
Amen.
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Lord.
Yeah.
Did you find Psalm 133?
Yes. Yes.
I love this little three-verse psalm. It's a blessing. Behold. Behold means not just to look at something, but it means take it in, comprehend it, grasp it, walk in it, live by it. Behold how good. Now, this word good in the original language means morally good. So it's the right thing to do. It's the right thing to believe and the right thing to do. Behold how morally good and how pleasant. And you know what the word pleasant means? Pleasant. How many of you'd rather have it pleasant than the other way? So it's pleasing. How good, how morally good and pleasant it is for brethren. And that word brethren, you know, in the Old King James here, the original word means close relations or family or people you're working with or people that are related to or people you're in the church with in your own fellowship. When brethren dwell together in unity, notice the word dwell. He's talking about a place where you live, a place where you're planted. The Bible says those that are planted in the house of God will flourish in the courts of God.
Yeah.
Part of the problem with people's lives is they don't know, they need to find out from God where they need to live.
Yeah.
Not only the city they need to live in, but the church they need to get planted in.
Yeah.
Well, you're a pastor, you would preach that. Yeah. No, I believed that before I was a pastor, that's why I'm a pastor.
Yeah.
Because when I got over me, and started following him and doing whatever he told me to and went through the growing pains and went through the God taking me apart and putting me back together again, killing that part of me that was killing me already. Then he finally got me far enough along where he could say, okay, now go ahead and step into what I called you to about 20 years ago.
Yeah. Oh, well, I just love this.
You do? Well, you can have a free copy of the CD.
Praise God.
Hallelujah. Well, praise God. Don't say we're not generous around here. So, he's telling us that we need to find that place where we dwell. You know, I'm a pastor here in Madera, and I look at myself as a pastor in Madera. I don't just see myself as a pastor of the believer's church.
Right.
This is my assignment here. This is what he's told us to do. But I'm a pastor when I'm at Walmart.
Yes, right.
You're a whoever you are or whatever you are in the body of Christ, wherever you're at.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Jesus doesn't leave you when you go to Walmart. Sometimes you may feel like Jesus left you.
Amen.
Or when you're driving down the street.
Yeah.
He might have to come to you and say, you don't know what spirit you're of. Anyway, just having some fun this morning. Spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down. Praise God. But he says, dwell together. Now I'm a pastor here in town, and so I look out and I see there's other pastors that are assigned to this city to be a pastor in this city, in this community, this area.
Yes.
So I walk in unity with them.
Amen.
I honor them as who they are, as a fellow brother or sister in Christ, also in the office they operate in. Who am I just because we disagree on a few doctrines that are not going to keep us out of heaven?
That's right.
To do the old, well, I'm a this and they're a that. Yes, I have things I believe, and I don't have any problem telling them that if they don't believe healing, God heals anymore, I do. But I'm not going to let that destroy my unity and my fellowship and my love with that member of the body of Christ.
Amen.
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 Why? Because the Bible says if you break a hedge, a snake will bite you. And we are hedged about in the love of God and in the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. And if you start breaking that, you just let the devil into your life. You align yourself with him and he's going to bite you in the backside.
That's right. Yes. There you go. Big time.
And he is a very poisonous snake.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Hallelujah. I love you. Amen. See, a lot of times people are looking for somebody with a certain special anointing to get them healed or out of something, but all they got to do is learn to close the door.
Amen.
Yes. I've seen that happen. I've seen the anointing come on people. You can, to a certain degree, when you operate in the anointing, you can learn that you can actually impose the anointing on a situation and on a person, and they'll get relief, and things will change, and so forth and so on. But if they go back and that door's still open, the enemy's going to come right back in and say,
yes.
Amen.
Yes.
See, some people want to give God their problems, but they don't want to give him their life.
Amen.
Amen. Yes.
Amen.
I found you've got to give him your life first.
Yes.
Yes. What do I mean by that? I'm yours, Lord. I don't have an opinion anymore. I have one, but it doesn't matter. I want the mind of Christ to function in me. I want you to tell me when I'm wrong. I want you to show me when I get out of line. David, you know, he even prayed and said, God, put a guard over my mouth. He prayed, may the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight.
Yes. Amen.
So dwelling together in unity. Now, you can come into this church and you can put on your Christianese face.
Hi, how are you? Oh, praise the Lord. Well, how about you?
Amen. But if what's going on in here isn't right,
that's right.
Don't fool yourself.
That's right. Yeah.
Now, there may be somebody that, you know, rubs your fur the wrong way. I know it's not me because I'm so nice. Amen. No, I'm just kidding. Now, sooner or later, if you had to live with me, you'd get ticked off at me probably about halfway through the day.
Amen.
I knew there was going to be an amen over here.
No questions.
I walked right into that one. We're all human. But the main thing's the main thing. God can work it all out.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Some people treat, some Christians treat sinners better than they treat other church people.
Amen. Yes.
Yes. Oh, come on.
Yes.
I'm not going to get off on that rabbit. I got to quit here.
Thank you, Lord.
Now let's look here.
I bet you're going to quit.
I love you, brother. I will not take offense.
I'm just thanking the Lord. Not
yeah, I know. The Bible says that anything that's divided will be conquered.
Yeah.
That's why the devil tries to make big deals out of nothing.
That's right.
Yeah. What Sister Bucketmouth said about you is not going to matter when you get to heaven. What Brother Blab criticized you over is not going to matter, and it doesn't matter now.
Right.
Yeah.
That's right. Amen.
What you think about yourself doesn't make a hell of beans in God's sight. I mean, it could affect you. You want to make sure you renew your mind. Get in the Word and find out who you really are and how God really sees you. Yeah, right. But your opinion really, you know, you're down there and you've got this opinion of yourself, and God goes,
pfft. I already said, yeah. Right.
Verse 2, it's like the precious ointment or anointing. Everybody say anointing.
Anointing.
Upon the head. And he says, when we live in this unity, he says there's an anointing that comes upon the head that ran down the beard, even Aaron's beard. Now, who is Aaron? Aaron was the high priest. If you read the book of Hebrews, now Jesus is our high priest in heaven. And the Bible says in Hebrews 1, he was anointed with the oil of gladness. He was anointed with that thing that causes blessing to come, that brings gladness and joy. So when you and I walk in the love of God, we have to transpose this out of the Old Testament into the New Testament. When we walk in this place, the high priestly anointing of Jesus. Now the high priest's anointing, the high priest basically was responsible for pretty much one thing and one day out of the year in Israel. It was the Day of Atonement. Matter of fact, it's coming up on the Jewish calendar over in October. Pretty quickly. The Day of Atonement was where the high priest prepared himself according to the commandment of God, and went into the place called the Holy of Holies once a year with the blood of animals in order to sprinkle the blood over the mercy seat, because on that Day of Atonement, God looked down at the law in the Ark of the Covenant that was in there, the commandments, but if the blood of atonement was sprinkled on behalf of the people who had judged their own hearts and had cleared their hearts before God, between them and God, between them and others, then when that blood was sprinkled, God saw the law that would have brought judgment to them because of their past sins in that year or their failures in that last year. He looked and he saw the law through the blood.
Yes.
And when God looks at you and I, he sees us through the blood of Jesus.
Yes. Right.
So that high priest was in charge of seeing to it that once a year, the sins of the nation were cleansed. Now, not everybody's sins were cleansed. If you read Isaiah 58, you'll see that people that were just going through the motions and weren't doing it from here didn't get the blessing. They were griping and complaining, just like in Malachi. How come we heard all this stuff? God heals, and he does this, and he does that, but he's not doing it in my life.
Yeah.
Well, don't ever point your finger at God, because he's never wrong. You need to make an adjustment somehow. Amen? But he says this unity, when we walk in this place of unity and love, it says the anointing that's upon the high priest comes down, and not only is the blood cleansing us, but the anointing follows the blood, and the anointing comes to break every yoke.
Amen.
While Beth would preach that message about the seven times Jesus bled from the Garden of Gethsemane till his death on the cross, he did a complete work. Every time he bled, he paid the price to redeem us from something. So the power of that redemptive blood, the power of that atoning blood that he told Mary, don't touch me, I haven't yet ascended to my Father and your Father, after he rose, he went up as the high priest and he applied his blood to the heavenly Holy of Holies. And the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 12 that that blood is continually crying out and speaking on our behalf. So that we've got things right in unity under the blood, walking and loving one another like we're supposed to. You know, we have sinned and we owe a debt we couldn't pay. Who do we think we are to hold some against somebody that owes us a debt that's a little Mickey Mouse thing compared to what we owe God? Well, I just can't forgive my sister because of what she said about me. I'm just hurt. I had one lady tell me she was hurt by that. And I understand, you get hurt. I've been hurt. I've had to deal with emotional hurt. I've had to deal with the feelings of wanting to go take batting practice on somebody's head. Come on. I said, well, how long? She said, 2 years. I said, you're not hurt. You're not forgiveness.
Yeah.
If you make a choice to do what Jesus said, and that is forgive the person, forgiveness is a decision. It's not a feeling.
That's right.
You choose to forgive, and every time the devil brings it up, you let him know, I forgive them. And you also tell him, if you want that person getting a lot of prayer, keep bringing it up, because every time you bring it up, I'm going to bless them and I'm going to pray for them. Yeah. You start doing that, the love of God rises up out of your spirit and starts wiping all that away, and the day will come when you wonder why you're even mad.
Yes. Yes.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
It's like the precious ointment. I've got to quit here. They're waving signs at me from back there. It's like the precious ointment upon the head that ran down the beard, even Aaron's beard, that went down to the skirts of the garment. Are you a member of the body of Christ?
Yes. Yes.
Are you a king and a priest with Jesus? That's what the Bible says.
Yes.
Amen. That anointing's flowing down to you, see. Praise God. The anointing, praise God. That's why you're called the anointed in 1 John. You are the anointed. Verse 3, as the dew on Hermon, and as the dew that descended upon the mountains of Zion, for there the Lord commanded the blessing into life forevermore. This is using an illustration of the mountains there that were the water source for Israel. The snows melted, came down, became the Jordan River. It was the water source of Israel. It's that which produces life.
Right.
The anointing is there to destroy the yoke. The anointing is there to break the devil's power. But then it says here that when you live in that unity, the life of God, the reign of the Holy Spirit, flows down upon you and begins to produce life in your life. And notice, I like this last part here in verse 3. It says, for there where? Right here. In you and me. For there the Lord commanded the blessing, even life forevermore.
Amen.
Yes. When God commands something, it's a done deal.
Amen.
Every angel in heaven comes to attention and begins to move in the direction of bringing that to pass.
Amen.
Did you hear me?
Yes.
So what he's saying here, see, and people read these last two verses, get excited. Woo, the anointing. Glory to God. High priest anointing. Wow. Break every yoke. And then life down here. Oh, yeah. He commands the blessing. I'm blessed, I'm blessed, I'm blessed. But if you're not doing verse 1, you don't even qualify for verse 2.
Amen.
That's good.
Amen.
Good word.
Yeah.
Amen.
Sure.
See, you don't try to earn a position with God.
No.
Or qualify.
No.
By human endeavor. But you do have to be honest with yourself.
Yeah.
Years and years ago, and I'll close with this scripture. How many of you hold me to it? Years and years ago, I read that scripture that said that God said to Abraham, walk before me and be perfect. That's what it says in the Old King James. I read that scripture and I thought, well, that's it for me. It's kind of like that all A's thing. You know? That's how I felt about that. I don't qualify for that. Years later, I found out the word perfect in the original language means sincere. See, you can't be a perfect person, but you can have a perfect heart. Not a heart that always has the right motives in it, but a heart that is sincere. A sincere heart will repent when it needs to.
Yes.
A sincere heart will always go God's way, regardless of the cost or of whatever it might make you look like. Or whatever you want. Testing, mic's still on. The Bible says in Ephesians 6, I said I'd quit with that one, didn't I? The Bible says in Ephesians 6, if you're going to put the armor of God on, the first thing you put on is a belt of truth.
That's right.
And that word truth in the Greek means sincerity.
Yeah.
See, God's not asking for you to be perfect. He wants you to just be sincere before Him, be honest with yourself about yourself, and understand that His love is great for you, and He wants you to extend the same for others. You see somebody struggling? Pray for them.
Amen.
Amen? Somebody offends you? Get over it.
Yeah.
Just attack it with the love of God. Smother it with the love of God. I'm not letting you have unity. See, my marriage is the same way. This goes for a family, it goes for a marriage, it goes for a church, it goes for whatever, your company. I'm not going to let the devil steal my marriage by me thinking, well, I got to be right, Karen's got to be wrong. She's just wrong, that's all. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to love Karen. I'm going to honor her. I'm going to serve her.
Amen.
I'm going to forgive her if I need to. But I'm going to have the marriage God wants me to have. Amen. Let's stop. Let's pray. Father, we thank you.
Thank you,
Father. There's so much more that God wants us to know about this. We'll get into it, I'm sure. Thank you, Lord. But I believe you got the basic point across today. Now, this is an atmosphere. When we do this, this creates a spiritual atmosphere. It's like opening up the door for the atmosphere of heaven to be there, the angels to work, the glory, the healing power of God, the goodness of God. Amen? And if we make a decision that that's how we're going to be, that we're going to walk in that, and we're going to do it, you just watch. God will show up in it. Yes. Amen? Father, thank you for your word today.
Thank you.
Several ways you've spoken to us today about this. Thank you for helping us. Lord, we know Jesus even taught us to pray that your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That you want to create the atmosphere of heaven on this earth. And you did it on the day of Pentecost when your people got in that room and got into one accord. Help us, Lord, all of us here today. We've had some fun with this, but help us, Lord Jesus, to just teach us, Holy Spirit. Teach us about this. Show it to us in our own life. We know it's not some big, heavy obligation, but that you're actually setting us free.
Yes.
Yeah.
That you're helping us, Lord, to let you carry the things you carry. And for us to walk in the things you called us to walk in.
Yes.
We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Bow your head for just a moment. Is there anybody here that hasn't received Christ as their Lord and Savior? You've never prayed and asked Jesus to come into your life? The Bible says that we're all born separated from God and His life and His family for eternity. That's the short version of that. And the Bible says that Jesus came and that He poured out His life. He died on the cross. He took our punishment. He took all that would keep us from being in God's family upon Himself. And the Bible says that if we are willing to admit that we're a sinner and that we need someone to save us from our sins and that we are willing to give our life to the Lord, then He's going to be able, then the Bible says, to give His life, His eternal life to us. So if you've never prayed a prayer along those lines and asked the Lord sincerely for Him to be your Lord and Savior, just lift your hand right now while everybody's got their head bowed and their eyes closed. So I can see your hand. I'm not going to point you out. I'm not going to embarrass you in any way or anything like that. But I am going to come into agreement with you in prayer. All of us are. Is there anyone here that's never received Jesus as their Savior? Anyone at all? Maybe you're here and you say, yes, I have received Him, but what you've preached today, there's been some conviction come to me from the Holy Spirit. And I see where I haven't really been walking in that love that I should be walking in. And I'm just making a decision today. I'm going to let the devil break the hedge. I'm not going to let Him come in. I'm not going to let Him have access to me. I'm going to choose to do what I've heard today. And I'm going to walk in unity with people, whether they walk in unity with me or not. I'm going to walk in unity with the Lord, and I'm going to walk in unity with those that will walk in unity with me. If that's you, you don't need to raise your hand, but let's just pray together. Lord, we come before you. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you, Lord, that you just come and you help us see the traps that the enemy would set for us. And Lord, you also help us see the door that's open into a greater glory. And I think that both of these have happened today. Things have been revealed where the enemy had set a trap, and the enemy was using the opening that he had in the hedge of protection to get in and to come against people. But also, Lord, as we close that, you're showing us that there's a door of unity, there's a door in the Spirit that causes the atmosphere of heaven to be within our midst when we come together. So we thank you. We close that one door in Jesus' name, and we open the other one. We go through the other one, Father, into that place of unity. We thank you. Teach us more about this as we read our Bibles, as we walk with you. and as we go with you in Jesus' name. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Well, let's stand. Praise the Lord. Everybody say it with me. The Lord is good.
The Lord is good.
And His mercies are forever.
And His mercies are forever.
Say this with me. This is the year of Jubilee.
This is the year of